Well, hello. Well, this is not my normal setup. Where is the next episode of Construction Paper Battlefield? Aha. Well, you see, I may have underestimated how much editing was going to be involved, but I want to leave you with a video this weekend, and hey, it is the holiday season. I think we should talk about some holiday events, and particularly involving historical events that occur around the Christmas season. Now, the United States has a quite peculiar trend with its history, particularly military history during the holiday. I mean, you got the Delaware River crossing, you got the aftermath of the Battle of Fredericksburg during the Civil War, where everybody's sitting on each side of the Rappahannock River freezing their butts off. You got the Battle of the Chosen Reservoir, where we're being, well, as Wikipedia puts it, UN strategically withdraws. Because we just can't say we were defeated. We can't say that, I guess. We're too high minded to admit that. So yeah, the United States got a thing for freezing its butts off during the holiday season. Well, we're going to talk about one of these events, but not in the way you're going to imagine. Have you ever heard of John Bell Hood? This guy right over here. Have you ever heard of the Battle of Franklin? Yeah, it didn't end too well for Hood. Have you ever heard of the Battle of Nashville? Oh, well, maybe I went a little far in some places. So what we're going to be talking about is the Franklin-Nashville campaign of 1864. And we're going to learn about all the trials, tribulations, and misfortune that John Bell Hood and his Confederate Army of the Tennessee suffered through. And I just realized I said the Tennessee. There are two armies of Tennessee in the Civil War. You got the Union Army of the Tennessee and the Confederate Army of Tennessee. And we're focusing on the Army of just Tennessee. They're not going to be freezing around the river like the Union are going to be. Now, General John Bell Hood was born back in 1831. He was actually born in Kentucky, but he'll be more associated later on in his life with the state of Texas. His father did not want him to be have a military career of any sort, but Hood's grandfather actually served under Anthony Wayne's command at the Battle of Fallen Timbers. See, there's my connection with the Northwest Territory. With the help of his uncle, Hood was able to get enrolled at West Point, and he actually graduated in the class of 1853. One of his classmates would have been
John
Schofield, who's going to be very important in Hood's life, but not the way he was expecting here very shortly. And he also, one of his instructors, was a officer by the name of George H. Thomas. Another very important person in his future, not in the way he anticipated. We'll get to that. Hood served out west in the 2nd U.S. Cavalry. Actually got into a little scrap with one of the native tribes out there and actually got shot for his left hand with an arrow, but minor scratch considering what's going to happen to that arm. Because of his term with the cavalry out in places like Texas, he remained in that state and essentially adopted it as his new home, all the way up till 1861, when Confederate forces fired on the Union fortress of Fort Sumter. As a result of this, Hood decided to resign his commission as first lieutenant in the U.S. Army and instead would join the Confederacy. At the onset of the war, Hood's going to take charge of a regiment, the 4th Texas Infantry Regiment. He is going to only be with them briefly. They end up getting split between the 1st Texas and the 5th Texas. I believe I have that right. May not. Who knows? Eventually, he'll actually take charge of the Texas Brigade in the Army of Northern Virginia, and he will lead them to quite success in the early part of the war. Hood was known to have a very ferocious attitude on the battlefield, which was not uncommon for Confederate brigade commanders. You're still in this day of chivalry and bravery, and you want to impress everybody by being the bravest person on the battlefield. Bravest. I just made a word up. Bravest person on the battlefield. We would call bravest person on the battlefield today the most insane person on the battlefield because I do not want to get shot. Nevertheless, Hood made a lot of decisive actions with the Texas Brigade, most notably during what became known as the 7 Days Battle. At a place known as Gaines Mill, he led the Texas Brigade in a charge. Hood at the head with his sword out front. You can visualize the painting. It's right over here if you need another visual of it. I'm sure you already thought of the painting in your head. Hood leading forward, you know, your typical bravado leader, and impressed a lot of the higher command of the Army of Northern Virginia, including Robert E. Lee. And Hood would work his way through the ranks. Eventually, he would take a divisional command later in 1862, and he'd be present for battles such as Second Manassas, at the Battle of Antietam. He is going to lead his division out onto the field, and including a Texas brigade I mentioned earlier, and boy, are they going to get into a vicious scrap. So much so that the 1st Texas, one of the regiments in Hood's former brigade, would suffer an 80% casualty loss, arguably the highest casualty rate of any regiment during the American Civil War. Up to this point, Hood has been putting himself into harm's way, but time and time again, he's been coming unscathed off the battlefield. And then he gets to Gettysburg. Now, at Gettysburg, Hood's division was part of James Longstreet's corps during the battle, and on the second day, quite famously depicted in the movie Gettysburg, Hood did not want to follow the orders that was being handed down to him.
If I attack as ordered, I'll lose half my division, and they'll still be looking down the throats at us from that rocky hill right there. We must move around to the right, sir, and take them from the rear.
Sam, the commanding general will not allow a flanking movement around those hills. I can't call this one off. You know it.
They don't even need guns to defend that. All they need to do is roll rocks down on you.
Just take it.
General, I do this under protest.
To be fair, it probably wasn't person-to-person interaction. It was probably all this was going correspondence between aides, but you get the point. So Hood goes off, leads his division down toward Little Round Top, get into the region known as Devil's Den, and then Hood is going to be wounded in his left arm.
You should have let me go to the right.
Hood would recover enough in time to be transferred with all of Longstreet's Confederate Corps to the Army of Tennessee, commanded by Braxton Bragg in the Western theater of the war. Now, a misconception the general public has of the American Civil War is that the whole war was fought in the Eastern Theater between D.C. and Richmond. And up until 1863, the Confederates were winning all the battles and they were going to win the war. And then Gettysburg happened and it all fell apart for them. It's far from the case. Out west, from the very get-go, the Confederacy was not doing so hot. And that is because of a guy by the name of
Ulysses S. Grant.
Grant was able to take Fort Donelson and Fort Henry at the mouth of the Cumberland and Tennessee rivers. Then he's going to move through Tennessee, get into Mississippi, and take the critical rail juncture of Corinth, Mississippi by the end of 1862. Then in 1863, the Army of the Cumberland, under the command of William Rosecrans, would move deep into Tennessee, targeting Chattanooga, another critical rail junction. If you control Chattanooga, you would open the gateway to Atlanta and thereby to the Atlantic coast. Now, Rosecrans was able to push the Army of Tennessee, commanded by Braxton Bragg, out of Chattanooga quite easily, but Bragg got timely reinforcements, including Longstreet's Corps, including our hero of the day, John Bell Hood. And on September 19th and 20th of 1863, Bragg's army, one of the rare times in the war, you got a Confederate army outnumbering a Union army, are going to defeat the Union army of General Rosecrans. And when I mean defeat, they completely split apart the force. Rosecrans, for the first time in the war, is panic-stricken and has to flee back to the safety of Chattanooga. Many credit Hood's division with opening up the gap in Rosecrans' Union line. Unfortunately, Hood was in the thick of the action and is going to take a shrapnel round to his thigh, his right thigh. Back to the operating table he goes, and this time he is not going to be able to save a limb. His right leg will be amputated 4 inches below the hip, completely gone. Now, this is where one of the big myths of General Hood begin. And I would like to break this myth before we continue. Yes, I'm making this video kind of tongue-in-cheek, pointing fun at, oh, look at all the horrors that happened because of General Hood. But something needs to be stated before we continue. General Hood, because of his amputation, popular myth brought out that he was being drugged to reduce the pain from his amputation and from his limp arm as well, that he was addicted to drugs for the remainder of his campaign. There is no primary sources corroborating this belief. In fact, the first text that really talks about drugged up hood is in the 1940s, and there's no sources about it. And more recently, the Hood family themselves unearthed a lot of the original paperwork involving the treatment of Hood after his injury at Chickamauga. And very rarely does he talk about pain, and though he was administered morphine, it was only on rare occasions. Now, I haven't found any information beyond his time in the hospital bed if he was ever purchasing any medications. I haven't found any evidence. And I believe what's going to follow of Hood is not so much that he was drugged up, because it fits very in line with the personality we've come to understand of Hood. This very fierce fighter, throwing himself forward. It starts adding up that it's less about drugs and more this is just the man's personality. While Hood is recuperating in Richmond, he's promised he'll be given command of an entire corps of the Army of Tennessee upon his return. Now, while he's recovering, he's going to interact with a lot of Virginia's upper class, and that is going to include a lady that he calls Buck. Her actual name was Sally Preston. Now, Preston took pity on Hood, you know, one-legged Hood, one-armed Hood. He's turned into a bit of a pirate at this point. Takes pity on him, and Hood takes this to mean that she's in love with him. And Hood pines to marry Preston. Preston keeps turning him down repeatedly, but before he goes off to go back and take charge of his new corps command, he has got a bit of a yes out of Preston. She's just kind of like, all right, if you're insistent. So Hood takes that. Yes, I have scored. So he's going back to the front lines, one-legged Hood, but very happy that he thinks he got his love life all sorted away. And then this is where all hell breaks loose. By the time Hood returned with the Army of Tennessee, Bragg had been replaced with Joe Johnson. Johnson was very popular with the Confederate forces. He, in fact, was one of the original commanders of the Army of Northern Virginia before he was wounded at the Seven Days Battle and replaced by Lee. Johnson was brought out west to try to relieve Vicksburg, Mississippi of a siege in 1863, but was unsuccessful, and now he's being brought in to replace Bragg, who had fallen out of popularity with just about everybody in the Army of Tennessee. But Johnson takes a very cautious approach. He is playing defense, keeps falling back in the face of this massive army now under the command, Union Army, under the command of Tecumseh Sherman. Eventually, he gets pinned down to the city of Atlanta. Jefferson Davis, president of the Confederacy, has his hand pressed, and he has to relieve Johnson of his command. Who is going to take charge of the Army of Tennessee in such a dire hour? Well, none other than our boy, John Bell Hood. One-legged Hood, he's going to save the day. When Hood took charge of the Army of the Tennessee, it made him... Tennessee. When Hood took charge of the Army of Tennessee in summer of 1864, he was just 33 years old, which makes him the youngest army commander on either side in the American Civil War. He has something pretty proud to be about. Now he got to show that he's deserving of being in this position. How's it gonna go?
Preparing to fire.
Hood is going to default to his fierce headlong attacks, but he's trying to translate that from a little brigade to an entire army. Doesn't go too well. On July 20th, he's going to attack forces under command of his former instructor at West Point, George Thomas. He's blunted at the Battle of Peachtree Creek. And then 2 days later, he's going to try to sweep around and outflank Sherman's army at the Battle of Atlanta, the actual Battle of Atlanta. And there's a very faint panorama painting I'm going to show right now in the corner, covering my face, my ugly face. But again, Hood was blunted. Hood would try then at Ezra's church in late July, July 26, and this time some of his soldiers refused to go to the front lines. They were horrified. By early September of 1864, Hood gave up the city, evacuated, Sherman moved in, took over the grounds. and we are now at a crossroads for Hood's life. Now, General Hood had two options with his Army of the Tennessee.
His Army of the Tennessee.
One, he can keep pursuing Sherman, or two, he can go north. So I got a lovely little map here, which is totally authentic, I promise you. I totally didn't just run down and bought a whiteboard at my local DG, and I totally did not cut my finger trying to open this. This is going to become a very bloody episode in more ways than one. So just to give you a bit of an idea, a bit of an understand of what Hood is thinking. Hood's army needs supplies badly. Now, if they keep pursuing Sherman, it's most likely not going to go well for them. He thinks that since Sherman is going toward the sea, Hood will take advantage and move quickly and capture the Tennessee state capital of Nashville, a critical rail juncture where there will be ample supplies in the Union fortresses up there should they capture them unoccupied. Now, of course, there is much hazard with doing this campaign, because if Hood's going to go this way and Sherman's going to go this way, what's going to happen to Georgia?
While we were marching through Georgia,
hurrah, hurrah,
we bring the Jubilee,
hurrah, hurrah,
the flag that makes you free.
But it ain't like the Confederacy got much supplies left with, at least not for the Army of Tennessee. All the supplies are being trucked up to Lee's Army of North Virginia, which is now besieged up in Petersburg. So, eight, we need supplies. We're here. We got to get to there. And if we don't get the supplies, we're losing the war. So it is October of 1864, and we are off. Now, as Hood pulls out of Atlanta, Sherman is going to investigate. There's going to be fighting around Allatoona Pass in early October of 1864. But Sherman comes to the conclusion that whatever Hood's going to do is going to be a Hail Mary. And as long as Sherman gets to the sea before Hood gets to wherever his destination is, Hood is going to go nowhere. Now, as Hood is going to be moving over and trying to find a good staging ground to launch his invasion of Tennessee, let's take a quick perspective over who's he going to be opposing. Well, we got his former instructor from West Point, George Thomas, with parts of the Army of the Cumberland way up here at Nashville defending the garrison. Now, Thomas only got about 20,000 people up there. He's going to need some reinforcements to overwhelm Hood's numbers. Down in Pulaski, Tennessee, we got the Army of the Ohio, which is commanded by Aon Schofield. Hey, it's Hood's former classmate. I wonder if they're going to get along very well the next coming weeks. It is the holiday season, after all. And there's going to be a few other garrisons throughout the Tennessee area that Thomas is going to pull from and wants to concentrate on Nashville. Thomas's idea is just let Hood come at him. I mean, let's be honest. At this point, Robert E. Lee is pinned down in the trenches of Petersburg. Grant is choking him out slowly. Where else is Hood going to go? Hood got to go through Nashville, nowhere else. We got all these nice fortifications in Nashville, too, so we're just going to use them. So Thomas is going to try to pull all of his forces back to Nashville, evacuating much of Tennessee. Meanwhile, Hood is going to be moving to Decatur, and I don't even know if that's how you pronounce it, but we're going to go with that, Decatur, Georgia. And then he's going to decide, you know what, I want to go to, you know, I did have the name written here. I'm not going to try to pronounce it. We'll just put it on the screen below. That's fine. And now he's going to start getting his forces together. This is going to cost Hood some time. It is only going to be till mid-November that he gets his full army, his full attack force together, which only amounts to about 30,000 soldiers. And I'm being generous for Hood here, 30,000 soldiers. Let's talk a little bit about Hood's rogues gallery, shall we? So the Army of Tennessee, and for the record, this is not meant to be a very technical history video. I am someday going to go back and explore these battles in more detail with more attention to detail. This is just me riffing off the cuff. But something to keep in mind is the Army of Tennessee was made up of four corps. Three of them are infantry, you know, your foot soldiers, which fight while walking on the ground. And those corps are commanded by Benjamin Cheatham, Alexander Stewart, and Stephen Lee. And you're going to have a cavalry corps, which is commanded by none other than Forrest Gump's namesake, Nathan Bedford Forrest. Do we need to talk about what Nathan Bedford Forrest has been up to during the Civil War? Oh, we do! Well, as a friendly reminder, earlier in 1864, Forrest's cavalry forces raided a Union fortress known as Fort Pillow, which was guarded by elements of the United States Colored Troops, African Americans, you know, the people that were in bondage, in slavery by the Confederacy, and, well, our boy Forrest didn't treat them like soldiers. In fact, he, did some dastardly things, which I don't, can I say what he did in YouTube? Oh, as a reminder, he slaughtered 300 Union soldiers who were surrendering. Our boy Forrest. What does his statue look like, by the way?
Ugh.
And what's interesting is we swing from the dichotomy, which is Forrest and future Grand Wizard Forrest. Oh God, don't want to look at that photo anymore. What's interesting is we have the dichotomy of Forrest over here massacring black Americans, and we swing over to one of the divisional commanders of the Army of Tennessee, Patrick Claiborne, which is actually an Irish immigrant. And Claiborne got into a little bit of trouble with the Confederacy earlier this year because, hey, funny thing he told the Army of Tennessee, this idea of fighting to protect slavery, not a good idea. It doesn't make us friends with the rest of the country. How about instead we take these people, how about we offer these people we're holding in this bondage and allow them to serve in our army in exchange for their freedom? That way we can bolster our numbers. This idea was not very popular with Jefferson Davis or any of the Army of Tennessee, so much so that when he proposed it on January 2nd, 1864, it was received with stone silence from his officers. Also, Claiborne got a comic. He's a comic hero. I don't know how to describe that photo. You decide in the comments below. I ain't touching that. By mid-November, Army of Tennessee is finally on the move. They are making their way into Tennessee. Schofield is going to evacuate Pulaski, and he's going to begin falling back toward Columbia, Tennessee. Ultimately, keep in mind, Schofield's goal is just to get to Nashville. He's trying to avoid holding his ground as much as possible. Now, around the turkey season of 1864, Hood is going to start skirmishing with Schofield's army around the town of Columbia, Tennessee. Schofield's expecting Hood to make a frontal assault. I mean, who can blame him? Hood's been doing it up to this point, but credit to Hood, he is going to actually make a flanking maneuver across the Duck River and get behind Schofield's lines. This is going to put Schofield into a bit of panic, and he is going to start racing for the town of Spring Hill. Now, by November 29th, 1864, Schofield's in a bit of a situation. His small Army of Ohio is divided between Columbia and Spring Hill, Tennessee. Hood is hoping to get around to the north of Spring Hill and cut off the major roads that are running into Nashville and then therefore divide. Hood hopes that he can decisively defeat Schofield here at Spring Hill, and then he can move on and attack the remainder of Thomas's army at Nashville. But things are about to get interesting. Now, as evening sets over Spring Hill, Tennessee, and Hood is starting to move the Army of Tennessee into position on the east and south side of Spring Hill, he's under the assumption that Forrest's cavalry is going to cut off the Columbia Pike on the north end of town, and on the south end of town, other forces are going to be able to move in and cut off the pike. He goes to bed assuming that. And what is Schofield to do in this situation? Let's think of putting Schofield's shoes. So here you are, you have the pike that goes south to north toward Nashville, but off to your right-hand side, no more than a few yards, is the entirety of your enemy, the Army of Tennessee. What are you to do to attack the army at night? Are you going to have to find a long detour around that could cost hours? He just decides to march right up the pike. And what does the Army of Tennessee do? Nothing. I kid you not. As far as we're aware, this is still one of the biggest controversies of the entire war. Somehow, Schofield moves the entirety of the Army of Ohio up the Columbia Pike, mere feet away from the tents of the Army of Tennessee, and nobody notices. My one coworker described this event just saying, would you imagine if one of these Confederates were going out and relieving themselves by a tree, and next thing you see is the Stars and Stripes going right in front of them? I don't think you want to be doing just number one anymore, folks. And how do you react in that situation? If you do see the entire Union Army marching right in front of your camp, how do you react to that? Do you raise the alarm and cause untold amounts of destruction? Or do you just... I also love, too, just admiring this map of Spring Hill, the Battle of Spring Hill. Look how the Confederate line is just such a peculiar design. So close, it's so close to the pike, but not quite, just not there, folks. So all night, Hood is being woken up by all of his different officers coming in reporting different signs of enemy movement to the south of Spring Hill, and then is getting reports there's movement of the enemy force to the north of Spring Hill. And Hood's getting grouchy and crabby. He's trying to sleep, so he's probably not able to put two and two together of what's happening. It wasn't until about 8 in the morning the next day when he wakes up and is moving toward Ripavilia Plantation. What a name, Ripavilia Plantation. Is that? I guess that's where Eric July is dining. When he's getting all the pieces together, what happened, that somebody didn't go through and actually block the pike. Somebody made a boo-boo. And when he gets into the dining room of the plantation, he unloads upon his commanding staff.
I feel I was denied critical need-to-know information.
He was furious. He was outraged. How could this error be made? How was nobody able to block the pike when he went to bed, it seemed like everything was going to plan? In some aspects, yeah, he's absolutely right to complain to his commanding officers. But in other aspects, when he starts questioning the honor, don't do that. We're dealing with diehard Southern boys here. You don't question their honor.
Honor!
Forrest is so outraged that rumor has it that he approached Hood after Hood's outburst and pointed a saber at his chest and threatened to kill him. Now, we can sit back here today and laugh at what Schofield had just achieved, but on November 30th of 1864, all Schofield is worried about is saving his ass. Schofield still got to get across another river, and then he got a dozen or so more miles to march before he gets to the city of Nashville, the safety of its fortresses. He is going to get to the town of Franklin, Tennessee, and he's going to find that the main transportation bridge has been knocked out by an earlier Confederate raid, or maybe a Union raid, I forget which one it was, and the railroad bridge is unable to sustain wagon loads being brought over. So he got a few hours to hold on in this horseshoe, essentially, in the town of Franklin, behind on the south side of the Harper River. Now, back at Ripavilia Plantation, where I'm sure Eric July is over there telling Hood to chill out, man. Well, that's what Hood needed. Hood is seething, and he ain't gonna be thinking straight for the next few hours. So, what does a commanding general do to take his frustrations out? Does he go underneath his drawer and pull out one of them nice little nifty punching bags to take all the stress out? God damn, you clinker! No, he doesn't do that. Instead, what he's going to do, he decides we cannot let Schofield get to Nashville. We have one more chance to prevent Schofield from uniting with the rest of the Union Army, and we are going to launch a headlong assault at this town of Franklin, Tennessee.
That idea may just be crazy enough to get us all killed!
Schofield has a fantastic defensive position. A year earlier, some earthworks have been built already south of Franklin. One of the armies had occupied it earlier in the war. Schofield's going to command the army to get to work shoring up those earthworks. There was a patch of Osage trees growing on what would become the battlefield as well. Those would be cut down and sharpened into abatis, the sharpened spikes on the fronts of the breastworks, making it very difficult for soldiers to easily climb over. And just to make matters easier for him, he actually got an actual fort on the eastern side of town, which if you get enough artillery in there, can shoot enfilading fire across what is essentially open farmlands for about 2 miles south of Franklin. what follows has been described by historians as the five deadliest hours of American history. Hood, at 4 p.m. on November 30th, 1864, commands the Army of Tennessee to begin a frontal assault on Schofield's earthwork south of Franklin. I don't think I need to really describe where probably what followed.
In the deep sea, advance the flag.
At the end of the 5 hours of fighting, 2,000 Americans are dead. Most of them Confederate soldiers. Yeah, the Confederates themselves would suffer 6,000 casualties. That's including killed, wounded, captured, missing. The Union would suffer 2,000 casualties. Amongst those killed, you would have 6 Confederate generals killed instantly or would later die of wounds received from the Battle of Franklin. In total, 14 Confederate officers were casualties of this battle. Amongst those generals that were killed, Patrick Claiborne. He was killed only a few yards from the breastworks. He initially rode with his division. He was described to be very solemn, to be depressed when he went into battle. He believed that it was a hopeless assault. His horse was shot off halfway through, and the last anybody saw of him, he was on foot, keppy on top of his sword, and next thing you know, he disappeared in the battle. The battle will start dying out around 9 p.m. on November 30th, and under the cover of darkness, Schofield will evacuate the Union Army across the river and continue the retreat into Nashville. Which means, if you want to be technical in some aspects, on December 1st, 1864, when Hood awoke, he decided to declare the Battle of Franklin a victory for the Army of Tennessee. What was left of the Army of Tennessee, anyways.
Did it, Patrick! We saved the Confederacy!
Now, most histories end here at the Battle of Franklin. They will add a very brief aftermath of what became of the Army of Tennessee. Nobody likes to talk about what became of John Bell Hood's Army of Tennessee. But that's what you're really here for, aren't you? You want to learn what happens beyond the breastworks of Franklin. It's not pretty, folks.
Our boy Hood does not learn his lesson and pursues Schofield all the way to the gates of Nashville.
Now, this video is mainly designed to talk about John Bell Hood and his wonderful adventures in Tennessee in winter of 64. But we also need to check over what is happening with the Union command. Let's take a look at what is happening with George Thomas. Now, by early December, Schofield and the Army of Ohio arrive. They're going to reinforce Thomas's command. Thomas is also going to be getting different forces from around Tennessee together. One of those is actually be an entire detachment of the United States Colored Troops, scores of regiments. By the end of the American Civil War, about a tenth of the Union Army would actually be Black Americans enlisted in service. Combined with all these elements, he has elements of the Army of Ohio, he has elements of the United States Colored Troops, he has elements of his Army of Cumberland, and he's going to have elements of the Army of the Tennessee. There we go, they're actually in here, the Army of the Tennessee. In total, he has about 70,000 men to defend Nashville. Sounds really good number. He has the odds number against Hood. But Thomas is not the most popular officer, at least not in the city of Washington, D.C. For you see, Thomas is a Virginian. Wait a minute, isn't Virginia one of the states that seceded from the Union to protect slavery? You would be right. You would be right, sir. But Thomas had his loyalties bound to the Union, to preserving the Union, and would remain in blue uniform throughout the American Civil War. Although his family at one point basically disowned him. His sisters reportedly turned his portrait to face the wall when he decided to remain with the Union. That's how you cancel people in the 19th century, I guess. And Thomas was often described as a slow commander. A slow, methodic, though successful commander. Thomas saved the Army of the Cumberland at the Battle of Chickamauga the year prior. When Rosecrans and the rest of that Union Army were fleeing back to the city of Chattanooga, Thomas stayed on what became known as Snodgrass Hill to hold off all of the Confederate Army, and for that he became known as the Rock of Chickamauga. Thomas is not popular in the eyes of Ulysses S. Grant, however. Grant is watching this entire campaign unfold as Hood marches into Tennessee, threatening Kentucky, threatening getting across the Ohio River. Grant is thinking of these worst case scenarios should Thomas fail to defend Nashville, or if Hood goes around into eastern Tennessee, God knows what's going to happen from there, how long the war will last. And Grant views Thomas's inaction staying in Nashville as him being unwilling to fight a battle, unwilling to go out and defeat Hood. And Grant is starting to suggest to higher-ups in the United States Army and in the United States government that Thomas should be removed from command. It gets so bad to the point that Grant actually tenders a letter demanding the resignation of Thomas, at least suggesting that it should happen. But that letter will not be delivered, for a horrible snowstorm blankets over Nashville. All right, let me give you a more simplistic visual of what all this mess is looking like. You got Hood entrenched on high ground south of Nashville, and for once, Hood is not actually throwing his men forward. He is entrenched, and he wants Thomas to throw himself at his own entrenchments. Well, Hood is gonna get what he asks for this Christmas. The morning of December 15th, 1864, sees General Stedman making an attack on the Confederate right. That's all the Hood thinks. But by noon, Hood realizes that this is just a feint, because, well, this is what the real attack plan looks like. Never seen it like this before. Now, Wikipedia, don't use that for information. Don't do that for research, kids. But I always love how they list results of battles. You know, they'll say Union victory, Confederate victory, and I mentioned at the start of the video their weird explanation of the result of the Battle of Chosen Reservoir. Look at this one for Nashville. Army of Tennessee, no longer an effective force. It's gone. It is virtually wiped out in this battle. You will not see the Army of Tennessee in this version again, but don't worry, they're going to come on one of them reboot tours. You know, like you get your popular TV shows and they get a reboot and it is not what you remember and it gets canceled after like a year. That is what the Army of Tennessee was in 1865, folks. If you want to look at the numbers damage, we are looking at 3,000 Union casualties compared to 6,000 Confederate casualties, and you can be assured that the number killed is heavily skewed to the Confederates. Hood's gamble had failed. Hood is completely devastated and exhausted from combat, and who can blame him at this point? I think most rational people are seeing the writing on the wall by this point, where this war to defend slavery is going. So in January of 1865, Hood will tender his resignation as commander of the Army of Tennessee. He actually wants to go out to Texas to raise an army to try to save the Confederacy, which, well, that never came to fruition. And in May of 1865, he will surrender Union forces. Yeah, I'm filming on a different day. Sometimes I need to take a breather before my brain goes too far into the depressing details. And then I start questioning, what am I doing with my life? Oh, let's check in. What's going on with Hood's love life? Well, Buck wasn't going to marry Hood after all. Later on, a diarist who was recording the love affair between Hood and Buck said that if Hood had been more persistent, Buck probably would have had it caved and agreed to marry Hood. But after what had happened at Nashville, after his Christmas in Tennessee, Hood was utterly defeated, both physically and mentally. But it ain't all bad for Hood. He will, after the war, he does get married. He has 11 children. Damn! And I'm not making this up. One of his nieces was a lady by name of Minnie Mae Hood, who became Minnie Mae Presley and was the grandmother of Elvis Presley. Do we see the relationship? I don't know. Hood moved to New Orleans after the war to raise his family. And actually, he made some maybe lukewarm efforts, but he still made some efforts to advise Confederate veterans to not join the white hooded men that we know who I'm talking about. I don't, you know, Nathan Bedford Forrest's group that he totally was not a part of. No, absolutely not. No. And I've always wondered what Hood would have done later in life had he would have continued on a redemption arc in a sense. But tragically, he died in 1879 in his late 40s from yellow fever. Yellow fever plagued his whole family. At one point, he lost his son, lost his wife. He actually buried his wife a few days before he himself passed away. Hood's Tennessee Christmas of 1864 was indeed a disaster on several scales, but was it single-handedly his fault? After doing the research and going through this video, I've actually come to the conclusion that Hood's plan was definitely bold, but had some intelligence behind it. I mean, we always hear about, you know, Hernan Cortez burning the ships to motivate his conquistadors when they came to the New World and things like that. And in a similar vein, whether it was intentional or not, that could have been a way to motivate the Army of Tennessee after losing Atlanta. Hey, you want more food? You want more supplies? You got to fight for all these Union soldiers and get to Nashville. But it's also a very reckless idea, and we see the results of it. Arguably, the linchpin of the campaign was at Spring Hill when Schofield was able to walk completely through the encampments of the Confederates without nobody noticing. You can easily blame Hood, but well, Hood's only one man, and he's given his commanders orders to take the turnpike, so it was his commanding deputies that should have overseen the taking of the turnpike, and they did not succeed. So Hood's to blame probably for not giving proper orders, but also his deputies are also to blame for not carrying out those orders or seeing the obvious. What I've come to the ultimate conclusion is General Hood's Christmas vacation to Nashville in 1864 was certainly bold, certainly had some grounds of standing upon, but because it was so bold, it was equally reckless. As tongue-in-cheek as this video is meant to be, it is important to also remember that the Franklin-Nashville campaign of 1864 impacted tens, hundreds of thousands of Americans. Those that were on the battlefield, think about those soldiers that may have survived had Hood not launched his invasion of Tennessee. Imagine the wives that are now widowed. Imagine the children that are now fatherless because of this campaign. And these families are going to receive the news of losing a loved one during the holiday season. Well, that got depressing. And before I ruin your holiday any further, it's probably best we wrap up this video. So thank you for sticking around to listen to me ramble through General Hood's Christmas vacation to Tennessee. If you want to see more videos like this, be sure to let me know in the comments section. If you enjoyed this video, hit the like button. And if you want to see more videos, watch more videos like this, subscribe to Readout Productions. And if you want to go the extra mile of supporting me, I do have a Ko-fi page. Link will be in the description below. Well, enjoy your holiday season, folks. I'll see you next time.